Do you like winning games of Smash? Enjoy destroying your friends? Maybe you want to win tournaments? Or even if you just really like Leffen, you need to become good at edgeguarding to fully achieve any of these things. But what's the edge anyway, and why do we care so much about guarding it? And for that matter, what's the ledge? Ledge is basically just edge when it holds NL. Only half kidding here. They're the exact same thing, actually. Ledge might be used a bit more at the end of the stage where you can grab on, but ledge and edge are interchangeable terms that can refer to the end of any flat surface. There's only one edge or ledge that we care about guarding though, and that's the one that the characters can grab onto when recovering. We're not really guarding it either. I don't want to hate on ledges here, but we really don't care about what happens to them. What we do care about is stopping our opponents from getting to the ledge. It's not like we have some overly jealous issues regarding the opponent's relationship with the ledge, but more so that we want to beat them, which can be done by taking their stocks, which can be done by not letting them get back to the stage. So edge guarding or ledge guarding, whichever you prefer, is usually the process of keeping your opponent off stage with the goal of taking their stock. Just like in real life, Smash has a mystical force known as gravity. Unlike in real life, there are spots where there's just no floor to stand on, but instead a blast zone that literally kills you if you fall into it. Needless to say, it's dangerous to be off stage because you can just lose a stock without even getting hit if you don't recover. There's also the side blast zone that you have to worry about, which leads to three primary ways that you can lose your stock off stage. The first is that you get hit into the horizontal blast zone. The second is that you get spiked into the bottom blast zone. And the third is that you just get gimped. GIMP is a complicated yet free photo editing program, but in Smash, it's actually a verb for hitting your opponent into a position where they can't recover, leaving them to fall to the blast zone at the ruthless hand of gravity. So, for our question of the day, what's the sickest edgeguard that you've ever pulled off? Let us know down in the comments and stay tuned, because in this video, we're going to show you everything that you need to know to master the art of edgeguarding. If you want to master every aspect of competitive Smash, then you should go straight to ProGuides.com. Our website is full of tips and guides for every character and dozens of techniques. You can learn from the best with our pro courses, featuring players such as MKLeo, and even get yourself a pro coach with our Play with Pros platform. You can also learn with us live right here on our YouTube channel. Our free courses go live weekdays at 12 p.m. Pacific, so subscribe and turn on notifications so you never miss them. Alright, let's get to the edgeguard. We're going to take the process step by step so you can understand exactly what your options are and what you should be looking for. The first step is kind of like a step zero. You need to actually get your opponent off stage. In order for an edgeguard to be practical, your opponent should be far enough off stage that you can get to the ledge before they can. Once you've got them off stage, it's time to hit them, right? Well, yes and no. The next step starts here, and that's recognizing your opponent's position. Where is your opponent and what do you need to do to get to them? If you've hit them very far off stage, edgeguarding immediately will probably fail, because you'll need to travel very far to sacrifice some of your own resources. Remember, even when you're the one edgeguarding, you have to deal with the risk of gravity and eventually recover yourself. There are, however, a few characters who can edgeguard without going off stage, and they can start their edgeguard right away. Moves like Snake's Nikita and Ness's PK Thunder can chase down opponents just about anywhere, and the edgeguarding character can stay in a comfortable position with their feet safely rooted on solid ground. Even if you have an option like this, make sure that you consider all the edgeguarding steps and possibilities that we're going to move on to, as there may be a better option for the scenario. Okay, Snake, Nikita is probably the best option for you. So, if you hit your opponent too far, you should wait until they're in position so you can reach them with your double jump. Characters with multiple double jumps will typically not need to wait as long, but understanding the exact amount of time to wait is extremely situational and depends on your edgeguarding options in each matchup. You also have a few options in terms of how long to wait. If you go off to edgeguard your opponent at the first chance, then you may miss an opportunity to catch them with a more vulnerable position. This brings us to our next step, which is reviewing your opponent's options. To connect these two steps, you still need to get into an edgeguarding position, and there are two ways to do this. You can run off the stage, which is usually best for edgeguarding opponents below ledge height, or you can jump off stage to edgeguard opponents above ledge height. Breaking these down a bit deeper, running off can also be used as a bait to catch your opponent smashing the panic button. Jumping can also be varied between a short hop or a full hop, and is sometimes also a bait to get your opponents to recover lower, where you can still drift down and hit them. Now that you've gotten into position, step 2 finally begins. Considering your opponent's option is one of the most commonly skipped steps by less experienced players, and it's actually important to understand. We can break down the opponent's options in two main categories, defensive options and recovery options. You need to now ask yourself, how does my opponent's character recover and what can my opponent do to avoid my ledge guard? The first offensive option to consider is jump. Especially if they're above ledge height, lots of players will double jump when you hop off stage to hit them. If successful, this jump is likely a full reversal of the situation, with your opponent now getting back on stage before you do. Because of this, you should try to become very aware whether or not your opponent has a double jump, and if they do, you need to account for it. Most simply, you can go for a double jump read by aiming an attack at the area above your opponent where they'll jump to. This read might just be your one-way ticket to lead smash, as offstage double jumps are possibly the most single common habit among lower level players. At higher levels, jumping here becomes a vulnerable yet risky mix-up. It's less certain what option will be chosen by either player, so sometimes this creates a 50-50 situation between whether a player will recover high or low. If you ever find yourself unsure of whether your opponent will jump and recover high or drop down and recover low, here's a useful tip. Even though that this can be a pure 50-50, the risk-reward is better if you go for a high ledge guard. This is because guessing wrong with a high ledge guard will leave you in a favorable position and you can easily drift back to on stage. But guessing wrong with a low edge guard will result in your opponent recovering before you, reversing the situation. This doesn't mean that you should go for a jump read every time, but just if you have no idea which option your opponent likes to go for. Jump isn't the only defensive option off stage, of course. Air dodging is common too, and it has a few variants. Neutral air dodging tends to be a great option whenever your opponent reads you low, and you can avoid one attack as you fall into position for your recovery. This can be tricky to punish in the edge guarding position, but it will leave you in a situation where you can probably recover easily. If you know that your opponent likes to go for those neutral air dodges, then you can probably just wait and follow with your drift, striking as soon as you see their air dodge complete. If your character has a decent aerial in front of you and below you, a good strategy is to position yourself beside them to suggest a horizontal aerial, which may lead them to air dodging below you and... This concept of deceptive suggestions is excellent for edge guarding and can even be a threefold process. First, your opponent is above you, so your position suggests the threat of your up air. Your opponent in this example is patient, so they drift in front of you. At this point, the position suggests your forward or back air, so your opponent air dodges and... Directional air dodge is sort of a hybrid between a defensive option and recovery option. I guess that you could say it's a defensive recovery option. This is because directional air dodges offstage will usually be done to grab the ledge. Directional dodging offstage is otherwise very laggy, so it'll either straight up kimp your opponent or put them in a situation where the recovery is pretty telegraphed. Directional air dodge has a vulnerability window when grabbing the ledge, so if you anticipate this, you should attempt to hit your opponent right as they grab it. There's actually another defensive option, although you may not really consider this one. Some opponents will use attacks to ward off edgeguarders, attempting to hit them before they even get hit themselves. This strategy works well against opponents who go for an instant aggressive edgeguards or for players who are trying to drift very close when waiting out an option. As the edgeguarding player, countering this tactic mostly comes down to spacing, making sure to stay out of the offstage character's range until an opening presents itself. Next, what are your opponent's recovery options? They'll usually go for an up B or a side B. As a quick note, recovery options don't have to be done before defensive options. They'll typically be the last thing your opponent does when avoiding your ledge guard, but there is no rule that says that they have to be. When factoring in your opponent's recovery options, you want to consider what mix-ups they have and how to account for them. Your opponent might use their up B early, for example, or they might just use a combination of recovery moves to stall and mislead you. With over 80 characters, there are so many possibilities, so the best thing you can do is study the matchup until you understand what's on the table. From there, you can pay attention to how your opponent likes to recover personally. When it comes to reads and guesses, it's never a bad idea to play it safe and feel out the other player until you get an idea of what they like to do. Mix-ups aside, there are of course the normal methods that your opponent uses to recover, and you should start by figuring out how to edgeguard those. Against characters like K. Rool and Fox, there are some obvious weaknesses that you can exploit, but with other characters like Game & Watch, they can be very tricky to edgeguard when they recover. Against recoveries like these, it's important to be aware of how early they can recover and still survive. When they're too far out to recover, you can go for an edgeguard, but once the recovery is in range, you might want to abort the mission. As we touched on before, you can run off to bait an early recovery and then punish it. Oftentimes, early recoveries won't grab the ledge directly, giving you time to punish. Another way to deal with those pesky recovery moves is going for the 2 frames. When grabbing the ledge from below, characters will be vulnerable for 2 frames, during which you can attempt to hit them with a well-timed attack. Long-lasting, low-hitting moves like Palutena's down tilt and Mario's dash attack are excellent for this. You can 2-frame an opponent from any position as long as you can hit them, but it's safer to stay on stage when attempting this. A character's hurtbox and ledge grabbing animation will change the easiness of 2-framing them. So, you've taken all these tips into account and successfully edgeguarded your opponent. is that it? Well, most of the time, it'll take more than just one hit to close out the stock, so our third step is continuing the edge guard. After you've hit your opponent, you have a choice between pursuing them further or recovering. If you still have resources like your double jump still available, then you might be able to land another hit before you recover. Otherwise, returning to the ledge refreshes your resources and also leaves you in a good position to repeat your edge guard. From here, we can move back to step one, and you can keep going until your opponent recovers or you take their stock. These examples all focus on launching your opponents away or downwards, but don't forget that you can also hit them into the stage for a stage spike. Stage spikes usually are not optimal as they can be teched, but at higher percents, strong attacks will become unteckable, making this quite viable. We sure hope this video will help you improve and fine-tune your edge guarding game. Be sure to check out ProGuides.com and subscribe to our YouTube channel and turn on notifications for more videos like this. Thanks for watching, I hope you guys stay safe, I hope you guys stay healthy, and have a great day.